first. Okay, this is the mycelia, how it looks like. Okay, huh? This is what we call as mycelia, the vegetative part of a fungus. This is like fungus lah, consisting of a network of fine white filament. So kita panggil mycelia. Dia nampak lah macam kalau let's say roti expired tu kan, kau nampak macam warna putih-putih, apa kulapuk kat atas tu. Tu so maksudnya fungus tu started bentuk mycelia. And then dia akan mycelia tu maksudnya gabungan daripada banyak-banyak hyphae. Nampak banyak-banyak hyphae ni akan form mycelia. Okay, so jelas ya itu mycelia. Okay. Okay. And then the genetic material in this organism is the naked circular DNA. Ha, DNA dia pun simple saja, naked juga. So everything that sini dia mention tak nampak tak apalah. But they have the normally ribosomes. Semua ni kat sinilah dia punya apa structure apa genetic material dia yang located inside here. DNA here, nucleot. So this is the circular DNA without the naked circular, without the membrane-bound organelle. So the nucleus without nuclear envelope. Maksudnya tak ada ni lah envelope ataupun yang melindungi dia. Okay. So absence of sap vacuole. Dia tak ada sap vacuole, tapi dia ada gas vacuole untuk apa? Maybe present for the maybe gas exchange, ya, pertukaran gas. So dia punya apa? Sap vacuole ni biasanya dalam tumbuhan adalah yang lebih higher level lah dia punya apa bentuk dia. Tapi kalau dalam Monera ni dia panggil gas vacuole sahaja untuk pertukaran gas. Maybe a simple respiration. Dia kan tak ada paru-paru, so dia punya structure for the respiration is very simple. So cuma pertukaran gas macam tu sahaja melalui vacuole. Okay, so the primary mode of nutrition is absorptive, ya, melalui penyerapan. So this is the main mode of the nutrition for Monera. But we have some group that are photosynthetic and chemosynthetic, but adalah yang boleh process their own foods. So this group we call it as holophytic. And then they are non-motile, tak boleh bergerak ataupun or move. Kalau bergerak, they are by beating of simple flagella or by gliding. So this is what I told you. We have flagella here for the movement, ya, untuk pergerakan. Ataupun dia secara gliding sajalah menggelongsor. So very simple movement. They are also important composers and mineralizers in biosphere. Means that they can uraikan macam bangkai-bangkai ke haiwan ke tumbuhan ke a simple nutrient cycle inside that can be absorbed by other organism. Maksudnya kalau bangkai itu atas tanah, so dia akan uraikan masuk dalam tanah jadi kita nutrient, so pokok-pokok dan tumbuhan lain boleh absorb that nutrients. Okay, they are mostly live in or on other organism as parasite. Kebanyakan mereka ni hidup sebagai parasite. Mereka akan hidup sama ada di dalam perumah atau host dia ataupun di atas perumah dia kita panggil host. So they are mostly a parasite, boleh menyebabkan penyakit ataupun keburukan lah kepada organisma yang dia apa hidup tu tadi. And then they also live in extreme habitats. Kawasan yang extreme. For example, hot spring, air panas. Desert, desert tu maksudnya kering, sangat panas kan, kering, tak ada sumber air, but they can survive. Snow, sangat sejuk. And then deep oceans, laut dalam yang masin semua. So they have very special adaptation lah to this extreme habitats. Nanti kita tengok apakah adaptation dia yang menyebabkan dia boleh survive dekat this extreme habitats. Okay, normally the mode of reproduction, pembiakan dia is asexually, whether by fission or budding. And then they have the absence of sexual reproduction. Dia tak ada pembiakan seksual lah because they are very simple organism. So means that kalau tak ada sexual reproduction, tak ada mitosis and meiosis saya. Okay. So this is the simple diagram that shows the Monera. So two members of Monerans, we have Eubacteria and Archaebacteria. So this is other kingdom. So I will be touched only here, Monera. And then Protistans, Protistan tu maksudnya members of Protista, kingdom Protista. Fungi, plants and animal will be covered by other lecturers. Okay. So this is the criteria on how we can classify bacteria, because we have for this protista, normally we have eubacteria and archaebacteria. So all is related to bacteria and how we classify them. So you can check the criteria here. We have the morphology, the staining. Staining ni maksudnya kita warnakan dia. Yeah? We have the reagent to differentiate the bacteria according to the color they retain, warna yang diorang ni lah absorb. And then in term of growth, nutrition, and so on lah. You can just take a look later on. So this is the table to show the comparison between each of these characteristic or criteria. Boleh tengok sendiri lepas ni ya. Okay, next let's take a look on the two type of bacteria in Kingdom Monera. Saya dah sentuh tadi archaebacteria and eubacteria. Okay, now let's start with archaebacteria first. Okay, archaebacteria is the most ancient bacteria. Maksudnya bacteria yang mula-mula wujud di atas muka bumi ni. Maksudnya when the earth is not suitable for other organism to live in, they are the only organism that can come and survive here because they have their special adaptation to adapt in the extreme environment. Mereka ada kebolehan istimewa untuk survive dekat persekitar yang kurang sesuai. So that's why we call them as the most ancient bacteria, yang paling first yang wujud di muka bumi ni, yang datang dan hidup kat sini. Lepas diorang datang, diorang akan ubah permukaan bumi ni, diorang macam kan decomposer and mineralizer, dia akan urai semua-semua bahan-bahan yang complicated, mineral yang complicated, and then bila dah ada kitar nutrient semua tu, gas semua tu, barulah hidupan lain datang, mula start colonize the earth. Okay. They are very special as they can live in some of the harshest habitat. Kawasan ekstrim yang saya sebutkan tadi lah. We have the extreme salty. Extreme salty is we call it as halophiles here. And then hot spring, very hot temperature. We call it as thermophiles. The bacteria can survive here. We call it as thermophiles. And then marshy area, we have the methanogens. With that, means that they can release methanogens. So this is one type of gas, yeah, gas methane. Yang boleh digunakan sebagai fuel, ya, boleh guna untuk masak juga. Okay, most of them are autotroph because they have the pigment, we call it as bacteriorhodopsin for the photosynthesis. Dia tak ada chlorophyll, tapi this is the pigment that responsible for the photosynthesis process, bacteriorhodopsin. And then they possess tRNA and rRNA with unique nucleotide sequence. That is the genetic material for this bacteria. And this group of bacteria can be divided into three groups. I already discussed here. We have the halophiles, thermophiles, and methanogens. So you can see that each of this group is defined based on the different environment. Yeah. Okay, like bacteria, they are prokaryotes, means that before a nucleus, means that they don't have a that means that their nucleus is very simple. Prokaryote means they have a very simple nucleus. And then most are chemotrophic. Chemotrophic means that they are using the chemical, bahan kimia lah, for their photo, for their synthesizing of nila food and other nila food, their food lah. So they are depend on the chemical substances, okay, to produce their own food. And then their uniqueness is because 56% of their genes were previously undiscovered in other organism. So means that their genes cannot be found in other organism because they are very special. For example, gene that can survive in halophiles, in hot spring, yeah, yang boleh survive dekat kawasan air panas. So they have the very special enzyme or gene that can make them to withstand, yang bertahan kepada higher temperature. So dia tak ada dalam organisma lain. So this is very interesting. Kalau kita boleh isolate gene bacteria ni, kita masuk ke dalam badan kita, kita pun boleh hidup juga kawasan air panas. Boleh ke macam tu? Adalah gurau je. Okay, but that is the meaning. They have the gene that is very special that can make them survive in a higher temperature. That's why they are very unique. Yeah? Their gene cannot be found. Tak boleh dijumpai di dalam organisma lain. That's why they are very special and they are living in a very special environment. Terlalu masin, terlalu panas, something like that. Yang tinggi kandungan methanogens. Okay. And then they found in anaerobic condition. Anaerobic here means that without oxygen, yeah, with high salt concentration, kadar kandungan garam yang tinggi. High T, T here refers temperature and low pH. So actually this is the condition on the primitive earth. Yang saya cakap tadi, earth yang mula-mula exist tu yang macam ni. Dia kandungan garam yang tinggi, suhu tinggi dan acidic, low pH. So tak sesuai untuk hidupan lain. So that's why this bacteria come and they modify, they change the environment, this primitive earth, and become a suitable environment for other organisms to come and colonize. Okay. And scientists believe that all life kingdom are descended from this group. Dia percaya, scientists percaya bahawa kingdom-kingdom lain ni berasal daripada kingdom ini yang paling basic. Ya, ada soalan? Tak ada? I heard someone is talking. Maybe I thought you want to ask the question. It's okay, you can just ask the question in the middle. Okay, tanya je soalan. Kalau awak raise hand dekat chat tu, saya tak nampak tau sebab saya view screen slide sahaja ni. So you can just buka mic tanya kalau ada soalan ya. And then, okay ni saya dah discuss ya. They can be classified into three group based on their habitat. Methanogen, thermophile and halophile. Methanogen tu can produce ni lah methane, gas methane, gas memasak. Okay, so we will discuss each of this group of bacteria one by one. So we started with halophiles. Or halophiles. Okay, I don't know how to pronounce correctly, but halophiles. Okay, halophiles. Okay, so this require environment 10 times more saline than ocean. Dia punya environment yang 10 kali lebih masin daripada laut. Kamu kata laut tu masin dah, but this environment that can be survived by this organism is 10 times, 10 kali lebih masin. For example, we have the Great Salt Lake and Dead Ocean. So this ocean is 10 times more saline than normal ocean, ya, lebih masin. That's why they able to balance the osmotic pressure. Kalau kemasinan tinggi, tekanan osmotik dia tinggi lah kan. So that's why they have the ability to balance their osmotic pressure and then resist the denaturing effect of salts, ya. Kalau tidak, dia punya sel akan mengecut lah sebab terlalu masin kan kawasan persekitaran luar dia. So air daripada badan dia akan mengalir keluar lah melalui osmotic process. Kalau kamu ingatlah proses osmosis tu macam mana, mengalir daripada mana ke mana. I'm not going to repeat here, ya. Nanti Google how the osmotic ataupun osmosis process occur, ya. So this is can be relate to their adaptation of this halophiles, ya. They use the potassium and other chemical substances, for example sugar, alcohol and amino acid, to balance their osmotic pressure. Dia boleh gunalah ion-ion yang available dalam di persekitaran dia tu untuk menyeimbangi dia punya osmotic pressure. Okay, the second group is thermoacidophiles. Okay, so kalau thermo here means that it is related to temperature. So means that this kind of bacteria can survive at a high temperature. So this is the range of temperature between 60 until 100 degree Celsius. Tinggi ya. Kalau manusia kita boleh survive sampai suhu berapa je? Suhu badan kita berapa? Suhu badan manusia?
37.
So kalau kita demam, biasa suhu kita akan berapa?
38.
Kalau 40 tu kamu dah
40 tu dah
terbelalak biju mata dah rasanya. So jangan main-main ya. 38.5 tu dah mula enzim dalam badan kita tak boleh nak ni dah ya. Tak boleh nak adapt dah. So you have to quickly, macam pergi hospital, dia akan masuk air nak bagi ni cool down your body temperature. So 40 tu saya rasa dah nak nazak dah tu. Habis jahanan enzim, maksudnya kita pun, sistem dalam badan kita pun gagal lah. Tapi you can see this bacteria, nampak suhu dia 60 hingga 100. Ish, bagus kalau kita boleh isolate gene dia yang boleh tahan suhu tinggi ni masuk kat badan kita. Kan? And then kita pun boleh hidup dekat kawasan yang panas. Kalau masak tu pegang macam tu je, tak payah nak pakai apa, sudik ke apa dah. And they also can survive at a highly acidic environment. pH dia in between 1 or 2. Ini sangat acidic ya. Kalau pH 1 hingga 2 ni. So this is the special adaptation or special ability of this thermoacidophile. Dia boleh tahan suhu panas dan juga berasid. Okay, normally they live in hot spring, kawasan air panas lah. Volcanic and hydrothermal vent, yang air geyser tu kan, yang memancut keluar tu panas ya. Because they able to withstand high temperature. Okay, they use ni dia punya energy source dia hydrogen sulfide H2S ya, sebagai energy source dia yang ada available kat persekitaran dia tu. And then they can precipitate bicarbonate to carbonate. Bicarbonate is H2CO3 to carbonate CO3 due to their activity. Maksudnya dia boleh menguraikan bicarbonate itu kepada carbonate, batu kapur ya. Okay, next, the second group is methanogen. So this group of bacteria can produce gas methane. Kita produce gas apa kita? Manusia, gas apa kita boleh produce?
Karbon dioksida.
Itu pun melalui yes, respiration. Ada guna ke karbon dioksida ni? Boleh buat apa lagi? Eh? Tak ada.
Diserap oleh pokok dan dihasilkan.
Tapi oksigen. So secara tapi tak ada, maksudnya tak ada gunalah untuk kita kan. Tapi kalau bakteria ni dia boleh produce gas metan. Kamu tahu tak gas metan ni apa? Pernah tengok tak?
Metanol.
Yalah metanol. Macam kalau kamu nak pergi camping, kamu ada macam portable stove tu, kamu akan pergi beli metan yang dalam botol macam aerosol tu, metan gas tu ya. Metan kita akan guna sebagai fuel lah untuk kita punya portable stove tu. Ya, gas memasak. Tapi yang Petronas tu, saya tak tahu itu gas lain. Ini tak yang simple, yang kecil tu. Dia ringan. So metan ni sifat dia ringan. So kalau kamu selalu pergi camping, dia ada macam dalam bentuk aerosol tu, botol kecil tu. Guna dengan portable stove tu. So itulah gas metan. Dia boleh produce gas ni daripada organic matters. And then normally these bacteria live in the gut of ruminant animals. Ruminant animal ni maksudnya haiwan ruminan lah, macam lembu yang makan-makan rumput tu, yang ada empat kompartmen perut dia, yang ada empat tu kan. Macam lembu, kambing, kerbau, semua tu lah. Ataupun dekat paya, swarms. And then dia akan mati, die in the presence of oxygen. If there is oxygen, dia akan mati. Dia terbalik dengan kita. Dia tak boleh ada oksigen because dia is anaerobic ya. Okay. So this is their role, decomposer and use in treatment of waste. Kita gunakan dia sebagai decomposer untuk uraikan bahan-bahan macam bangkai ke semua, ataupun untuk merawat sisa-sisa macam kumbahan, tumpahan minyak ke semua tu lah. So we can use this bacteria because it can decompose ya. Kompleks molekul, molekul kompleks ni macam minyak ke apa ke, kepada simple dan boleh diabsorb oleh ada source lah, macam tanah ke, pokok ke, ataupun haiwan lain ya. Okay, they use carbon dioxide, CO2 as their carbon source and hydrogen as energy source. Okay, this is their carbon and energy source. Okay, methane gas is produced as their end product, ya, hasil akhir. For example, from the dung of this animal. Kalau let's say ruminant animal, so gambar ni macam gambar lembu, kalau dia membuang, so najis dia tu ada metan. Sebab metan ni yang ada dalam ruminan ni lah, dalam gut dia, dalam usus haiwan ruminan ni. So dia boleh produce metan. That's why bila dia membuang, so this is the gas. Kita boleh collect dia ya. Kalau dekat negara-negara macam India ke semua, gas metan ni banyak diperoleh daripada ni lah. Gas-gas dia bela kat banyak haiwan ruminan ni kan. So dia kumpul and then dia gunakan untuk memasak.
Doktor.
Ya.
Kalau dalam manusia ada tak?
Tak ada lah, sebab dia duduk dekat ni ruminant animal. Ha, ni metanogen. Manusia tak ada dalam badan, dalam usus kita tak ada metanogen ni. Kita ada bakteria yang kamu minum macam yogurt tu kan, apa benda? Lactobacillus bacteria. Itu bakteria baik yang untuk pencernaan usus. Dia duduk dalam ni, nampak ni, ruminant animal. Kamu ruminant animal ke? Ada empat kompartmen kamu punya ni usus. Tak kan? So ini untuk ruminan sahaja, haiwan ruminan sahaja ada bakteria ni. Okay, nampak ni natural gas. Okay, so they can this methanogen can be used as a natural gas. Okay, this the second bacteria is eubacteria. Okay, so ini lebih higher sikit lah kelas dia. We call it as true bacteria. Bacteria yang sebenar lah. Mungkin lebih complicated, lebih orang kata systematic sikit lah dia punya structure, cell structure tu. So, because they possess of rigid cell wall made up of peptidoglycan. Dia ada cell wall ya dalam eubacteria ni yang terdiri pada peptidoglycan. Jangan confuse, cell wall ni bukan pokok je ke ada cell wall, betul tak? Tak. This cell wall is given to the bacteria to show that nak tunjukkan bahawa fungsi dia adalah untuk menyokong ya structure bakteria ni. Tapi dia bukan keras ataupun macam rigid macam dalam pokok atau tumbuhan. Sebab kalau dalam pokok atau tumbuhan tu, they are made up of cellulose. Cellulose tu sifat dia macam itulah, very rigid. And then kalau cell wall bakteria ni, dia made up of peptidoglycan. Jadi protein, simple, lembut saja peptidoglycan ya. Tu beza dia ya, cell wall. So don't get confused. And then the cell membrane contains lipid, which is consisting of glycerol and ester lipids. And they have the flagellum. Flagellum is plural. Kalau banyak flagella presents in motile eubacteria. So as I mentioned earlier, flagellum is function in a motility. Berfungsi untuk pergerakan. For example, we have this kind of bacteria, E. coli. Okay. Okay, this flagellum rotation resemble propeller of a ship. Maksudnya flagellum ni bergerak macam kipas kapal tu, berpusing macam tu. Ha, itu yang membantu bakteria ini bergerak. This is how the flagellum move. And then some of them contain pili. Pili ni for the sexual reproduction. Nanti kita tengoklah pili tu macam jejarum yang keluar daripada badan bakteria tu. And then for the attachment to host, untuk dia melekat dekat host tu. So for example, this pili is actually possessed by the pathogenic bacteria. Bacteria yang berbahaya lah, bacteria yang menyebabkan penyakit. Senang cerita, bacteria jahat lah. Okay. So we have two group of bacteria in this eubacteria. The first one is gram-negative bacteria and the second one is gram-positive bacteria. Nanti kita akan discuss lebih detail how we can classify these two group of bacteria. Okay, so normally all bacteria ni sama ada eubacteria or archaebacteria, they share five common characteristics, which is single cell. Memang ada, they are all single cell, and then they also prokaryote, which is they have no distinct nucleus. Nucleus sebenar lah yang complicated macam dalam higher organism, macam dalam pokok ke, dalam animal ke. So their nucleus is very simple. DNA is not surrounded by membrane. They are very, they are naked. Yang kita kata tadi, naked DNA, tak ada membrane yang menyeliputinya. And then the cell organelle are not surrounded by membranes. Tak ada membrane juga yang menyeliputi other cell organelle macam mitochondria ke apa ke. And then their DNA is a single chromosome, satu sahaja ya, single. And then normally they reproduce asexually by binary fission, pembelahan dua. So this is the common characteristic for bacteria, archaebacteria and eubacteria. Okay. So now let's take a look on the bacterial shape, bentuk bacteria. We have five common shape for the bacteria. So bila kita observe bawah mikroskop, kamu boleh nampaklah bentuk-bentuk ni. So kita boleh kelaskan this bacteria into this shape. We have the coccus. Coccus is sphere shape, macam gambar ni. And then we have the bacillus or rod shape, bentuk rod ya, macam ni. And then spirillum, spiral shape. Spirochete, also spiral shape, but in I think this one is more like a 3D dimension. Dalam bentuk 3D gitu nampak kan. Kalau yang spirillum ni macam 2D saja, 2D lah dimension, 2D dimension. And then we have the vibrio or curve shape rods. Dekat sini vibrio, bentuk macam koma gitu. Okay, usually bacteria are named based on their morphological characteristic and given special prefix. Kita ada bagi prefix ya kalau kita nak namakan bacteria tu. According to their morphology tu, maksudnya dia punya ni lah bentuk dia. And then kita bagi prefix. For example, diplo for two. Kalau ada dua. Coccus ni ada dua biji. Diplo, coccus. So there must be a prefix in front of the shape. Diplo, coccus, diplo, bacillus ke. Okay. That is for the diplo tu. Strepto tu bentuk chain, macam dalam bentuk more than two cell. So bentuk berturutan macam rantai. So we call it as strepto. Strepto, macam ni kan, streptococcus ke, banyak-banyak chain. Kita tengok. And then staphylo tu for the macam bentuk anggur, gugusan. We call it as staphylo. And then bacteria can be classified by their shape, staining reaction, nutrition and respiration. Nampak kita kelaskan bacteria ni berdasarkan ni one shape. The second one is staining reaction ni macam mana kita warnakan dia, dia akan jadi warna apa. Biasanya ada dua je, iaitu bacteria gram negatif dan positif. Kalau gram negatif warna merah, kalau gram positif warna biru nak purple gitu. So itu kita saya akan explain lepas ni nanti. Kita ada special topic for the staining reaction of bacteria, nutrition and then respiration. Okay, so this is the for the bacterial shape. We have cocci living as separate. Kalau coccus tu satu, cocci tu more than one lah. Living as separate cell are called monococci. Kalau duduk satu je cocci. Pairs are called diplococci. Chain strepto lah. Kalau chain strepto and grape-like clusters are called staphylococci. This is the example. Staphylo, strepto, diplo is two. Okay, spiral bacteria exist only as single cell. Kalau spiral dia satu je ya, dia tak ada apa diplo spiral, tak ada. Only spirillum sahaja, okay? So this is another example of the prefix and the shape. You can take a look later on. For example, in pairs, coccus in pairs, diplococcus. Apa coccus in grape cluster we call as staphylococcus, okay? I already mentioned before this. Okay, now let's take a look on the bacterial growth pattern. This is the graph that you can obtain when you plotted the number of bacteria in log, yeah, bukan in numbers but in log and time. Okey, maksudnya bila kamu grow kan bakteria tu dalam culture. Culture tu maksudnya media dia di makmal, letak dalam satu bekas katakan dalam flask ke, lepas tu kamu observe dia punya pertumbuhan dia. Kita adalah cara method untuk count dia punya number of bacteria colony ni. Tapi sebab dia terlalu banyak, bakteria ni kan cepat replicate kan. So we have to use the log ya. Kita nombor dia, number of colonies of the bacteria have to be convert into log ya, dalam log ya, because kalau tidak 20,000 ke 200 ke jenuhlah nak plot kat sini. So we have to log the number of bacteria. Jadi kecil lah, jadi 1-3 macam tu je. But in log ya, dalam log ya. Okay, so we have 4 phase for the bacterial growth pattern. Ada 4 phase. The first one is lag phase. Means that dalam media dia tu, dalam kata dalam nutrient broth dia tu, dalam kita nutrient broth tu maksudnya dalam medium yang digunakan untuk membiak bakteria ni, kita panggil broth. So kita masukkan bakteria tu, okey, mula-mula kita letakkan bakteria tu, dia masih lagi macam orang kata rusa masuk kampung lah. Dia macam tengok sekeliling, dia baru nak adapt. Oh, ni rasa macam ni, dia punya nutrient. So dia tidaklah membiak dengan replicate dengan banyak lah. So static nampak ni, lag phase, masih lagi dalam perasa fasa penyesuaian with the environment. Tapi bila dia dah get used to the medium, media tadi, dia akan mula replicate dengan orang kata exponentially. So banyaklah, the number of bacteria is increasing dramatically. So banyak, so we call it as log phase, or kalau kamu Google ada juga dia kata exponential phase, boleh juga. So this phase can be log phase or exponential phase. Okay, dah dia membiak banyak ni, media tu kan dalam flask katakan, bekas tertutup. So dia ada limited kan, bila dah banyak duk makan nutrien yang sama, dia akan jadi macam semakin berkurangan nutrien tu kan. So bila nutrien tu semakin berkurangan, sedangkan bakteria semakin banyak, so bakteria tak boleh membiak dengan jayanya lah. So dia akan jadi static balik. So we call it as stationary phase, static phase lah. And then bila dah semakin lama kandungan nutrien dalam flask tu semakin berkurangan, dah tak ada dah, so dia akan mula matilah, memasuki death phase. Okay, so this is the bacterial growth pattern. Jelas ya? Jelas kat sini ya?
Yes.
It's very simple. Kita pun macam ni juga nanti fasa kita hidup manusia kan. Dia adalah. Okay, so this is the structure of prokaryotic cell structure. For example, we have flagella. Nampak ni, ha? Ni yang banyak ni lah pilih yang saya katakan untuk attachment to the host, untuk apa, tadilah untuk dia macam melekat dekat host mana yang dia nak jangkiti. So they have their pilih. And then ni lah structure-structure lah, you can take a look later on. So I just highlight these two important structure for the movement and then for the attachment purpose, ya, pilih. Kalau satu dia panggil pilus, kalau banyak pilih. Flagella, kalau satu flagellum, kalau more than one flagella. Ni silap lah ni, tak apa. It's just apa, term noun, apa, plural noun, and ni lah singular noun je. Okay, this is how the flagella arrangement in bacteria. Macam mana susunan flagella ni, kita ada peritrichus. Ini A, peritrichus sekeliling. And then we have the monotrichus. Mono means one. So we only have the one side of the flagella, flagellum. And then lophotrichus are both side, and then amphitrichus only one side with more than one of the flagellum. Okay. Next, the second characteristic that can be used to classify bacteria is nutrition. Okay, so most eubacteria are heterotroph. So I think already state emphasized before this, the meaning of heterotroph means that they cannot produce their own foods, ya, dia tak boleh buat makanan sendiri. So they obtain energy by breaking down organic molecule from their environment. Dia tak boleh buat sendiri, tapi dia boleh breaking down because they are decomposers kan, and mineralizer. Dia boleh breaking down the organic molecule from the environment into a simpler form, dalam bentuk yang lebih mudah. And then some of them are parasite. Biasalah bakteria ada yang parasite. Kalau parasite, they will absorb nutrient from living organism. Kalau let's say dia duduk kat mana? Kat perut. Dalam perut ke apa ke, dia akan absorb lah. Ataupun dekat permukaan kulit ke, dia akan absorb daripada itulah organisma tersebut lah nutriennya, because they are parasite. And then others are saprobe. Saprobe means that they can decompose dead organic matter. Dia boleh menguraikan bahan-bahan organik yang mati, macam bangkai haiwan, bangkai pokok, tak cakap bangkai, macam dahan pokok yang mati-mati semua tu lah. So that is the saprobes. Okay, some eubacteria are autotroph. Ada juga yang autotroph, ya. Means that they can produce their own organic compound. Dia tak ambil organic compound lah, tapi dia buat sendiri organic compound tu. For example, we have the cyanobacteria. This is the autotrophic bacteria, ya. Or we can call it as blue-green bacteria. Because warna dia blue-green, ya. They are autotroph using light for energy. Dia orang boleh guna, dia orang pula. This bacteria can use light, ya. Cahaya sebagai tenaga dia. Tapi they are lack through chloroplast. Chloroplast ni bukan macam yang ada dalam pokok lah. Very simple sahaja. That's why we call it as lack of true chloroplast, ya. Tak sama dengan chloroplast yang ada in plants. Okay. So I already put the what we call this table to show the mode of nutrition, energy source and carbon source for each of this group of bacteria. Photoautotroph, for example, energy source dia is light lah. They have to have their light source to produce their energy source, and then their carbon source is carbon dioxide and so on. You can just make a comparison between each of this group. Okay, nanti buat comparison. Okay, now let's discuss the Gram staining. Okay, so this is how we can stain, tu maksudnya kita nak warnakan. We want to give bacteria colors. Why? Because the most of the microbe is colorless and highly transparent structure. Kalau kita tak warnakan dia, kita tak nampak. Kalau kita tengok mikroskop pun, mikroskop pun nak nampak apa, sebabnya sangat orang kata lut cahaya. Okay, transparent. So that's why we need to stain them, which is staining is a process in which microbes are stained, diwarnakan. Okay, so this is the method. Now this is the bacteriologist that developed this method. So the name of those bacteriologists is Danish bacteriologist Hans Christian Gram. So nama dia tu ada Gram kat belakang. I think Gram is dia punya surname, family name dia. So that's why dia letak dalam method ni supaya orang akan ingat dia sampai bila-bila. This method is developed by him. So macam itulah kalau kamu jumpa apa hukum apa-apa ke, kamu nak letak nama kamu, boleh. Macam hukum apa, banyaklah. Semua tu based on the name of the scientist that discovered those rules. Okay, based on this reaction, bacteria classified into gram positive and gram negative. So the cell wall composition different lah, maksudnya warna bagi gram positif and gram negatif ni berbeza kerana kandungan cell wall composition bagi these two bacteria is different. That's why it appeared with a different color when we stain them. Okay, how we want to stain them? That we have a few staining reagents. Staining reagent ni agent pewarna yang digunakan untuk mewarnakan bacteria tadi, kan. We have the crystal violet. Okay, this is the primary stain. And then we will use the Gram's iodine. Iodine ni macam lautan iodine lah. Okay, this is the fixative or mordant, the role. And then we have acetone. Acetone is a decolorizer, nak nyah warnakan. And then lastly, we have safranin, or we can use to dilute carbol fuchsin. Normally dekat lab kita guna safranin lah. This is counter stain, nak warnakan balik yang mana yang boleh retain ataupun menahan warna tu daripada tidak di ni, tidak hilang. So kita akan boleh tengok warna tu nanti. Okay, so this is the principle of Gram staining. Macam mana? Okay, crystal violet maksudnya all bacteria take crystal violet. So all of them will appear violet. Violet tu macam warna purple sikit, kan. Okay, lepas tu, after that, we will, when we stain the bacteria, we need to, you will be learning this part actually in a microbiology, but I will just explain a little bit method or principle involved in this method. Okay, maksudnya kita prepare slide yang, tahu kan slide untuk view bawah mikroskop? Slide kaca, tahu kan? Kita pun ambil bakteria tu, kita letaklah dekat slide kaca tu, disperse sikit dia punya structure tu. Kita akan letak dengan crystal violet. Lepas tu kita akan rinse bawah air pipe secara slow lah. Buka slow je. Okay, kita lepas kita letak crystal violet, kita bilas dia di bawah air pipe. Lepas tu dalam beberapa saat saja, lepas tu kita warnakan balik, kita wet mounted balik slide kita tu dengan iodine solution. Lepas tu kita bilas balik bawah air pipe. Lepas tu kita akan letak aceton. Okay, normally aceton ni sebagai kita kata tadi tu lah. Kalau ni, mana tadi? Dia akan decolorizer. So kalau dia tidak retain ni crystal violet ni, dia apa gram iodine dia boleh nyah warnakan iodine tu, iodine warna macam dark brown macam tu kan. Dark brown pula, warna biru-biru gitu kan. So dia boleh decolorize kalau bakteria tu tak boleh pegang structure, tak boleh pegang warna iodine. So dia boleh akan inilah decolorize. Okay, and then kita dah bilas bawah pipe, kita akan letak balik dan kita warnakan wet mounted guna safranin. Nampak safranin. Lepas tu kita cuci balik bawah pipe. Nampak dia banyak structure, banyak 4 kali lah cuci bawah pipe. Letak bilas dia punya ni kita panggil ni staining reagent ni. So kamu wet mounted, kamu bilas. Wet mounted, bilas. Ikut ni lah. So bilas tu beberapa saat ya. Bawa air pipe. Okay, dan kalau safranin tu dia boleh only colorless bacteria takes appear pink. Maksudnya kalau warna bacteria tadi tak boleh retain violet iodine ni, dia akan jadi warna pink. Sebab safranin ni warna merah, pink-pink gitu ya, dia punya solution. So dia hanya akan jadi warna pink kalau dia punya structure dia tu memang kosong, bukan kosong, tidak berwarna. Maksudnya warna, mula-mula crystal violet warna biru. Lepas tu kita bilas. Lepas tu kita masuk iodine. Kita bilas. Lepas tu letak aseton. Dua-dua warna ni akan dinyah warnakan. Tapi ada bakteria ni dia boleh pegang ni crystal violet iodine. Dia boleh macam retain. Warna tu lekat dekat dia punya structure. So dia takkan appear pink lah. Dia akan appear biru nanti. Mana ni? Okay. Nampak ni. Dia akan jadi, kalau pink campur biru, biru daripada crystal violet, dia akan jadi macam purple macam ni. So kalau yang tak ada warna, nampak kat sini dia warna decolorization ni sebab kita letak aceton. So bila kita letak safran ni, dia akan jadi warna pink. So kalau warna pink, when you view under microscope, it is the gram negative. Tapi kalau gram positive, nampak ni. Kita letak crystal violet tadi warna purple kan. Bila kita bilas, dia jadi macam letak iodine semua tu, dia akan jadi warna macam purple sikit. Bila letak warna ni, dia akan jadi ni lah bawah mikroskop. Purple macam ni. Sebab dia ada, dia sedia berwarna di sini. Dia tidak ternyah warnakan dengan aceton tadi. So kalau warna biru, gram positif. Kalau negatif, warna pink. Okay? Warna pink-pink sikit macam ni. Okay, so this is different color is caused by the, ni lah, dia punya structure dalam cell wall dia. Okay, so if you take a look, the cell structure for gram negative, dia punya peptidoglycan tu, the cell wall, mana peptidoglycan, tak ada sini. This is the peptidoglycan in cell, in gram negative is thin, ya. Nampak ni sikit, nipis je. But in gram positive, the peptidoglycan layer is thick, tebal, ya. So that's why dia boleh retain the color of pink color of the safranin. Dia boleh lekat warna tu sebab dia punya peptidoglycan sangat tebal. Yang ni pula nipis sahaja. And then ada lagi layer-layer kat luar dia, so dia tak boleh retain warna pink warna pink safranin. Okay, so this is gram negative, this is gram positive. Sekejap. Okay, this is the previous slide. Okay, so this is the structure lah saya nak tunjuk. Gram negative, peptidoglycan dia yang merah ni thin, nipis, and peptidoglycan in gram positive is thick, tebal, ya, yang warna pink, warna merah merun sikit ni. Okay, this is the cell wall. Cell wall is made up from the peptidoglycan. Tadi saya dah sebut kan, bukan daripada selulose macam plants. So cell wall of bacteria is made up of peptidoglycan. Okay. Okay, this is the gram positive. So when you view the bacteria under a microscope, you can see this kind of color. Ini daripada slide kita lah bila kita view bawah microscope. So I think already sebut tadi, gram positive bacteria have thick cell wall made up of peptidoglycan. That's why it can retain the crystal violet stain. That's why it become the stain purple. Crystal violet ni warna purple lah. Violet. And then most of them are chemoheterotroph, and then some of them are photosynthetic. This one is must be the cyanobacteria. Okay, now generally they are less pathogenic compared to the gram negative. Mereka kurang berbahayalah berbanding dengan gram negative, ya. So this is the example of gram positive bacteria. We have actinomycete, lactic acid bacteria, mycobacteria, and so on. So this is a few example of gram positive bacteria. And then we have the gram negative. So this is how the gram negative bacteria appeared under microscope when you view them after the staining process. Yeah, so it can appear the red or pink, something like that. Red, okay, red because we have the safranin. Safranin is actually the red in color. And then they have the thinner layer of peptidoglycan. Yeah, most of them are pathogenic. Yeah, semuanya adalah berbahaya. Okay, now let's take a look on the respiration. Habis dah staining, kita akan tengok respiration. Okay, cellular respiration in bacteria differ in the oxygen requirement. Sebabnya ada bacteria yang perlukan oksigen. Ada yang bila oksigen ada, dia akan terbunuh or killed. So, we can classify their oxygen requirement based on the respiration, under a respiration. Okay, so if respiration requires oxygen, we call it as aerobe. Yeah, aerobe is require oxygen. Okay, if oxygen is absolutely necessary for survival, we call it as obligate aerobe. Maksudnya, if oxygen is needed, kalau tak ada oksigen ni tak boleh survive. So that is the obligate aerobe because some of the bacteria they still can survive with either in the existence of oxygen or not. Dia boleh survive. Ada oksigen ke tak ada, both can survive. Tapi kalau dia memang kena, perlu oksigen sahaja untuk survive, so this bacteria is classified as obligate aerobe. Okay, bacteria that carry out respiration without oxygen is anaerobe. Means that this bacteria is, this bacteria doesn't need oxygen to survive. So we call it as anaerobe, without the oxygen. But if the presence of oxygen kills some bacteria, we call it as obligate anaerobe. Wajib, tak ada bacteria. So this is obligate anaerobe. Sorry. This is what happened when you talk too long. Bila cakap banyak, dia rasa pedih kerongkong. Okay, for example, we have the Clostridium botulinum. Okay, this is the bacteria that can cause or produce toxin. And normally exist in a food. So this bacteria can cause the food poisoning. So this food poisoning is called the botulism phenomenon. Yeah. Kalau kamu keracunan makanan ke apa, normally this kind of bacteria yang menyebabkan keracunan tu. Sebab bacteria ni boleh menghasilkan toxin. Yeah. That's why you are becoming macam cirit-birit, muntah and so on. Okay. We also have another group of bacteria which, this is what I told you earlier, they can survive with or without oxygen. Both condition can be survived by this facultative and aerobe. So tak ada masalah, ada oksigen ke, tak ada oksigen ke, they both can survive. So you have to remember this term, aerobe, obligate anaerobe, dan facultative and aerobe, this term. Kena ingatlah. Okay, next is the reproduction. Okay, pembiakan. Okay, bacteria reproduce asexually. Asexually by binary fission. They are divided by binary fission. Nampak ni? Pembelahan dua lah. Means that the mother or the parental cell is similar to the dia punya offspring dia. Sama je. Cell yang asal ni dengan cell yang dihasilkan ni sama. In binary fission. The parent cell divide into two offspring cell that are completely identical. See that? The replication or reproduction of bacteria, for example, E. coli is very, very fast. Very, very fast. They can produce between 10 and 100 million bacteria in, nampak ni, 12 hours. Berbilion-million bilangan dia. Sebab dia kecil kan, kita tak nampak. So dalam masa 12 jam nampak the number of bacteria produced. So that's why we need to plot the number of bacteria in log. Sebab 100 million jenuh lah nak kira, nak buat graf nanti kan. So that's why the number of bacteria have to be plotted in log. Yeah? Okay, sexual reproduction does not occur. Tak adalah sebab dia organisma yang sangat simple. So they are very simple. So they does not undergo the sexual reproduction. However, genetic materials can be transferred between individual. Dia boleh transfer genetik between these three method. Whether the transformation, transduction or conjugation. This is how the bacteria transferring or exchanging their genetic materials. Okay, so this is how the transformation occur. We use the a cell or a dead cell that are taken by another bacteria. Okay, so this is how the transformation And then we have the conjugation. So this is the pili or pilus. Pilus ni macam jambatan yang terbentuk between these two bacteria to exchange the genetic. Dia macam jambatan lah to exchange the genetic material between the these two bacteria. Okay, and then we have the transduction, a transferring process from one bacterial cell to another bacterial cell. We are using virus. Kita guna virus sebagai medium ataupun sebagai orang kata pengangkut lah untuk transfer between one bacteria to another bacteria. So this virus can bring the genetic material from bacteria A and injected into bacteria B. So we use the virus. Yeah, this is for transduction. Okay, now let's take a look on the endospore. Endospore or resting bodies of the bacteria. Okay, normally most gram-positive bacteria form endospore when the environmental condition unfavorable environmental condition. Maksudnya kalau persekitaran tu tidak sesuai untuk dia membiak ataupun dia reproduce or replicate. So they will form a resting bodies that can withstand the environment, the harsh environment. Okay, for example, extremely unfavorable, macam terlalu acidic ke, terlalu macam masin ke. So they can form or macam protect themselves using this endospore. Tadi ada yang tanya kan, macam mana how this lower organism protect them, because they don't have the macam nucleus dia tidak di baluti membrane, a membrane bound organelle. So this is kind of protection for this bacteria. They have endospore, yeah, resting bodies. Okay, endospore actually DNA and a small amount of cytoplasm enclosed in a tough cell wall. Nampak dia ada cell wall yang lebih rintang. Kalau macam keadaan yang acidic, dia bahkan boleh melawan. Cell wall tu boleh melawan keadaan yang berasid, ataupun kalau kamu makan ubat. So antibiotik kan. So dia nak lawan antibiotik, kesan antibiotik tu dia akan form ni lah endospore as a protection. Because tough cell wall can resistant to extreme in temperature, drying and harsh chemicals like antibiotics. So this is how bacteria or kingdom monera protect themselves, yeah. Okay, any question so far? Last, we already come out to at the kata last part of our lecture, the importance of bacteria. Bacteria ni bukan semuanya tak ada peranan, ya, ada juga beberapa peranan dia. Okay, first is in biogeochemical, where they play an important role in recycling nutrient, because they are decomposers and mineralizers. So they can change the complex molecule into a simpler molecule or nutrient which can be absorbed by other living organism. For example, we have nitrogen, oxygen and so on. And then they can decompose the organic matter. So for example, actinomycete SP and mycobacteria. So dia boleh menguraikan bahan-bahan organik. For example, bangkai tadilah. And then they also the primary production. This is for the photosynthetic bacteria like cyanobacteria. Yeah? So they can produce the photosynthetic bacteria. And this bacteria also can be used in food preservation and fermentation. Fermentation kan kita guna yeast kan. Yeast pun macam dalam kelas ni jugalah, microorganism ni lah. So they can be used in this lah, food processing, ya, food preservation, nak preserve makanan tu lebih tahan lama. Or industrial chemical untuk produce certain chemical kan, for the certain reaction. And then pathogenic organism to plant and animal. So means that they also can become the pathogen, ya, kepada organisma, to plant and animals. And this bacteria also can be used, as I mentioned earlier, oil spill clean up. Kalau ada sisa tumpahan minyak, we can use this bacteria to clean up the oil spill. Oil spot removers, meat tenderizers and in a laundry starch. Dalam meat tenderizers tu untuk melembutkan daging, untuk menghilangkan sisa-sisa degil dekat ni lah kita punya pakaian. We can use this kind of bacteria because they can produce a special enzyme in a laundry, dalam dobi-dobi semua tu lah. Okay, so we also have the bacteria that can metabolize oil. Macam tadilah kita boleh guna bacteria ni untuk menyedut sisa tumpahan minyak, speeding the natural breakdown process. So minyak tu akan ditukarkan kepada bentuk yang lebih cepat, ya, dan terurai dan senang diabsorb oleh hidupan lain. So bersihlah kawasan tumpahan minyak tu. Bacteria also can synthesize and store PHA. PHA ni actually can be used in various biomedical application including drug delivery and tissue engineering scaffold. This is more like in a biomedical application lah. And some bacteria can produce ethanol, macam methanogen tadi kan. Bacteria can produce methane and other ethanol gases lah. Okay, so that is the importance of bacteria. Any question? Okay.
No, madam.
No, so you are very clear.